That we're on air.
Okay,
we are now live.
Great. So all the talk this week is about the tariffs, and I don't really think it matters what party or what president or what group of people is proposing a tariff. What's the problem with a tariff when you're thinking about the free market economy or just liberty in general?
Well, any tax is something that makes it harder to buy and sell. It's harder on the buyer, so it's also going to be harder on the seller because, you know, in order for people to exchange goods, each side has to be happy. So anytime you put a tariff on something that is coming into your country, you are taxing your own people because they're going to have to pay more to buy that thing.
That makes sense, yeah. And I also feel like it's just punishing people because I know a lot of people like to buy a BMW, or maybe they want to buy a product that's made in China, or they want to buy a fancy watch. I just don't feel like a tariff, if you truly believe, and it has nothing to do with political party or the presidency or anything like that, it's politicized right now, but many Democrats are in favor of tariffs when they're in office or when it meets their interests. So it's not that they're magically like opposed to tariffs all of a sudden. They just don't like the person that's proposing the tariff at the moment. I think that's kind of the gist I'm getting from it.
Right. Well, it's also a protectionist thing. So once you have a tariff on imports, that means that you're not, the local merchants are no longer competing with the whole world. They don't have a level playing field. So now that they can sell you higher goods at a higher price because they have less competition. However, what you're really inviting is smugglers, because anytime it's illegal to sell something, or any time the price of something becomes extraordinarily high when you buy it legally, there will be people who will find a way to bring it across the border and not pay that tax. So that's what you're inviting.
That's true. And people always forget about that. Like, it's called the black market, right? I think that's the term, like the colloquial term for it anyway.
Right. And it's not necessarily a bad thing. You've got to remember that we have many, many examples of black markets that save people's lives. So if you have read my book, Our Lady of Kaifeng, in the second part, they're in a concentration camp run by the Japanese. And the Japanese only give them so much food. And you can also buy some extra from the guards. But you know, there are people across the wall who are willing to sell eggs. And the people inside the concentration camp really need to buy eggs because eggs have all the nutrition you could possibly need in a very small package. And so there's buying and selling that happens there. And people are dying for it. Chinese people were executed for the crime of selling eggs to the people in the concentration camp. You know, so that happens. And when there's smuggling, you know, then there are people like Jean Lafitte who eventually ended up saving the United States. But what was he wanted for? He was selling goods that did not pay the tariff.
That's interesting. So the tariff thing, it goes way back in time to the beginning of American history, essentially. And I think you were going to discuss a little bit about an article you wrote on pub wages about who pays for war.
Yeah.
How that relates to war.
Yeah. Because, you know, one of the things that we're told is, why do we have to have taxation? Well, taxation pays for civilization. It keeps the enemy out of your gates. It puts a wall between you and other people, and that's good because it protects you. It prevents the enemy from, you know, attacking you and taking your property and your land and whatever. So then the question is, how are we going to pay for that? And we always wanted in the United States, I mean, the British offered us protection. And that's what the tax on tea was all about. You know, mm-hmm. it was just a little tiny, tiny tax.
Yeah, a little bit.
The taxes that we're paying right now, it was nothing.
I know.
It was supposed to pay for those redcoats who unfortunately were also quartered in the houses of colonists, Americans.
Mm-hmm. So, the quartering, I remember that.
Yeah. So basically, they were the police and they were also the military. They were both of those things at once. And these are supposed to be things that we're willing to pay for with a tax, but we were not willing to pay because we didn't want that. We figured we could protect ourselves some other way. Mm-hmm. So we fought the revolution, and that was against those taxes and against having a standing army. And that was part of what all of the founding fathers were talking about. We don't want a standing army. We do not want to go to war every day with all sorts of foreign countries. We want to remain at peace. We want to be open to do business with everybody under the sun. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, they got into some debt while they were fighting the British. And then the question was, how are we going to pay for that? And Alexander Hamilton had an idea. And I bet you know what that idea was.
It was right? A national bank, right?
Well, I mean, he said that we should have tariffs. And what's so funny is he said, let's not have tariffs on everything because, you know, some things are necessities.
Oh, like the things he wanted.
But let's do it on luxury items. So then he started to list luxury items. Tea, because you don't have to have tea, right? Coffee, you don't have to have coffee. Whiskey.
Yeah.
And in fact, whiskey is such a pernicious luxury. Let's go ahead and put that tax not only on whiskey that's brought in from outside the United States. Let's put it on all whiskey.
Oh yeah, the whiskey.
Okay, so basically had a whole list of these luxuries. These were all things that people in those days generally mm-hmm. went to the store to get, you know, if they didn't make it themselves. So so he put up this he suggested to pay off the debt with this tariff and even to get more debt. He said that it would be really great for us for our credit rating if we were in debt so we could show that we were paying back the debt. So he wanted to get into more debt and we were going to have this wonderful revenue. It's not the Internal Revenue Service, but it's going to be a revenue service. And it was called the Revenue Cutter Service. And those were people on ships who were supposed to stop other people, other Americans, and make sure they paid the tariff when they brought things in. So that was, you know, that was how we got that. And after that, you know, under... So this is Alexander Hamilton's idea. Now, do you know what Thomas Jefferson's idea about how to pay for waging war was? It's a little bit different. He was on a different side of the coin.
I'm going to have to reread about that because I don't remember exactly. But if you wanted to share.
Sure. I mean, Thomas Jefferson was different. So Alexander Hamilton was a Federalist. And he was, mm-hmm. you know, he was very well liked by George Washington, and he was well acquainted with Adams, and he was all for the quasi-war with France. And then when everybody was tired of all of this because it was too much like the British, you know, it was more like what we had under the British, so they decided they would vote for the other party. And the other party were the anti-federalists, you know, that they were the Democratic Republicans led by Thomas Jefferson. Jefferson didn't like war. In fact, he wasn't very good at war, so he wanted to have peace. And so he decided, you know what? rather than go to war to defend our ships, let's just have an embargo. Let's tell all our ships not to go anywhere, not to sell anything to any foreigners. We'll stay home. We'll be safe. And we won't have to pay any special taxes in order to do that. But if any ship does go away and try to do business, we are going to say that they're criminals and we're going to stop them.
You know, that's so ridiculous.
Yeah, so that's the other side of the coin. So when Jean Lafitte showed up, there were two things going on. There were tariffs, but there was also an embargo. You know, it was supposed to pass. There was not going to be any business. Of course, people hated that because, you know, the United States is not an island. It's always done business with other countries. There was all of trade. We couldn't stop everything. So, but the point of the matter was that there was a provision in the Constitution for people to be ready for war, and not necessarily by having a standing army. So, of course, we know about militias.
Yeah, the state militia.
Yeah, you could call the militia if there was a need for it. But there was also a provision for privateers. And so people could have letters of marque. They wouldn't necessarily have to be letters of marque from the United States. It could be from another country. So, you know, during the quasi, when there was this war between France and England, and there were various people in the United States were fighting on various sides, many of them were privateers for France. France gave them letters of marque, and they went and they fought, and they made a living that way. So they are people who make a living off war, but they were not paid by our government. And it's better that way. You don't have
to incur debt, right, first off?
Yeah, there's no debt. There's no taxation to be paid for that. And if the French are paying for it, well, that's not our problem.
And it also make war less, fewer people would die because, for instance, when we send many, many people into a war that in Iraq or Afghanistan and people are injured and dying, it becomes more wide scale after a while because the larger the occupation becomes, the more people they have to send in. And it just, if a foreign government has a letter of marque, it might be for a more strategic thing that meets their interests as opposed to us thinking that we're nation building. Yeah,
exactly. Like Jean Lafitte had a letter of marque from the Republic of Cartagena. It's a very, very small country. It's basically a city state in what is now Colombia in the in South America. And all they wanted for him to do is to fight Spain, you know, to keep the Spaniards at bay.
Yeah, and that was their only.
Yeah, unfortunately, because Commodore Patterson, and it was sacked and burned by the Spaniards. But what he was supposed to be doing was defending them from the Spaniards.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it would have been something strategic. It wasn't a wide-scale war that didn't have, like, an exact purpose. It seemed, in that case, what Lafitte was commissioned to do with his letter of marque made more sense, perhaps.
Yeah, and the thing is, if somebody has to pay for it from their own pocket, then they are going to limit how much money they spend. So, for instance, when a privateer starts out privateering, because that's what he likes to do, you know, he's not going to spend his money on the best ship available that is most seaworthy. He's going to buy a junk, you know, a very best. And who pays for that? The American taxpayer.
Yep. And that continues on until today. Like, you have things as minuscule. I remember watching the show this lady made a camo paint, and she was talking about how she became a millionaire because she was commissioned by the military to sell this, like, just anything, like many different products. And they make it, war is a money making industry for sure. Like, people have a vested interest in continuing.
Well, the problem, it's not a money making industry. If the government actually had to make a profit, they would not. They're very wasteful.
Oh, well, the government's wasteful, but there's people that are profiting from it individually, is what I'm saying. Like, government contractors, like the lady who makes the camouflage paint. That's what I meant.
Yeah.
The government.
No, they pay way too much. They pay entirely too much. They're very wasteful. And, you know, that's a problem with war. War is about resources. War is about, are we going to have this land? Are we going to have this oil? Are we going to have, but if it's right, and the people shouldn't be paying the salary.
There should be, people don't get anything from these wars.
Right.
We're not getting anything back as players. Definitely not. Especially like these last few wars that we fought, there has been nothing that I would say the American taxpayers have received from that. They always tell us, well, it's for our security, but no, actually it's not. Especially these last few conflicts, it's nonsensical. We don't even really have a vested interest in some of these latest conflicts, but some defense contractors and some politicians who have relationships with them, they have a vested interest in making money off of it personally.
That's crony capitalism. I mean, that's what that is. And it's a problem, but the other side of all this, one of the reasons that we're given for all these wars currently is we're out to save children. We're out to save women. We're out to save people because...
More people are dying because with these conflicts, every time that they say that, this is why, not to make it completely political, I think Trump is a blabbermouth, but people keep saying it would have been better with Hillary. But we have to remember what she said during the debate about how she wanted to impose a no-fly zone in Syria. So she was basically saying that she wanted a full-scale war in that country, which that would have caused more death, more destruction. But people are like, she would have been a better president, but I don't see how. I think she would have dragged us more into war than he has. Like, he's done a few things, but I don't think he's as war hungry as she was. You know what I'm saying? She's very big on our strategic interests. She's always saying things like that. So
Well, I agree. The thing is, there are two reasons why people support war. Some people, it's because they actually think we're going to get something like oil. A lot of liberals actually think this is a humanitarian mission. And it's not, because every time you say you're going to protect other people from different morality in a different country, you're going to end up killing people over this.
Yeah.
Including people, women and children.
And people die, but in these recent wars, okay, you have a dictator who, yes, he's done a few atrocious things. He's invaded some local countries. However, they are always these secular leaders, and then you overthrow them, you dispose of them, and then the people that fill the vacuum are extremists, and they're killing people en masse and creating instability. So I don't see how you can claim to be compassionate and then think that's a humanitarian mission and not know what's happening geopolitically in these countries, and then say that. That's the problem I have with that. And also, too, when it's a Republican, Democrats are anti-war. Like, they'll protest wars, but then when it's their guy going to war, and this is something that I had to come to terms with myself, all of a sudden it's okay and it's a humanitarian mission. It can't be different. It has to be equal, you know? It's the same. It's not any different. That's what really bothers me about this. How is it humanitarian when a Democrat does it, but when a Republican does it, you protest. It's the same thing. They're doing the same thing.
Yeah. Doesn't matter who does it, and even if it's in our own country. So what happened at Mount Carmel near Waco in Texas was, oh, look, they're doing something bad to children, so let's bomb them and let's put gas in there and let's burn the place down and with the women and children and everything, because that's a great way to save them.
Yeah, I remember being, when I was a kid, that was very disturbing. I was like, how did that result in that, like, in that ending? Like, how did it get to that point, you know, and why was there a standoff? And then in the end, what they said, was that even really happening, or was that just a speculation? Did they have proof that was even happening?
It was not within their jurisdiction, but nobody cared. You know, there was a McLennan County. This was in McLennan County in Texas. And they do have child protective services. And yeah, there was a divorced guy who had a child within the compound because his wife happened to choose to join this cult. And I don't have a problem calling it a cult because, as far as I'm concerned, every religion is a cult. Okay.
Every religion is a cult.
Right. Okay. So the guy was concerned about his child, so he complained to McLennan County Child Protective Services. Full had jurisdiction over that. They decided nothing bad was happening. Then the ATF came in and they said, oh, they have guns. Oh, my goodness, they have guns. And we think they have a few illegal guns, you know, because, you know, it's not illegal to have guns.
Yeah.
It's not illegal to have as many guns as you want.
Mm-hmm.
So they were saying, but we have good reason to believe that they have some kind of gun that we're not allowing people to have.
Oh.
No evidence of that burned down. There was no evidence of, you know, weapons of mass destruction or whatever you want to call it.
They were just looking at
killer guns.
Straws, basically, and looking for any reason to do what they did, specifically because they wanted to justify their actions.
But you know what? You know, the problem is I did contact the libertarians. I did contact all sorts of people, the Quakers and every single one of those groups didn't want to get involved. And I think it was because of the smear that they made against that particular group of people.
Mm-hmm.
And to this very day, I mean, I can't talk to anyone in the libertarian camp or even the Austin Peterson camp and get a straight answer of, yeah, that was wrong. You know, they would just rather not talk about it.
It's a very, I found it very, as a 14-year-old, watching the news, I found it very troubling, and it never really made sense how it came to that point. And it seems like they were a cult, and were they didn't really need to be, like, confronted that way. There were many other cults in this country, like, they're a cult, basically, but because of that one.
Basically, what did David Koresh do? He lectured about the Bible and the seven seals every day. I would get bored. I really would.
Yeah, it'd be boring.
That's the reason.
But it's like the Hellbop cult, okay? The Hellbop cult, like, he would get people to he got people to commit suicide with him, and he got people to go eat the same pie with him and to dress up in crazy outfits, but nobody was, like, cornering them, and because they were all adults, I guess, like, that's okay, you know? But there's so many cults. Like, there's many...
There's no evidence that Koresh was doing anything, you know, bad. It was just weird, but
it was weird. Like, but it sounds like it started with that man, and he was upset that his wife, like, it was a custody thing, and then it got blown out of
control. One straw that they were grasping at, but I think there's more going on there. Their property, somebody wanted their property that they had the compound on, and on top of which... this had something to do with the Clintons, because the first people to get killed in the original raid were people who used to guard Bill Clinton.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, I've heard things about that. Like, some people, I mean, I don't know, like, all the details, but there are people that say that the Clintons have had some interesting... There was an Unsolved Mysteries case about that back in the 90s about somebody that was murdered that was somehow affiliated with the Clintons. I'm not saying that I know about that. I've just heard people talk about it. But it's
I'm saying that there are a lot of circumstances, and that's not my main issue with the thing.
I'll hear about that later.
But there were all sorts of motivations that had nothing to do with what was going on in the Quarish camp, in the Mount Carmel Branch Davidian compound.
It sounds like they kind of had a personal interest in whatever was going on. Like, it wasn't... It seemed like they blew something out of proportion so they could justify what they did, basically. And it should... What they did wasn't right. Like, it never should have been handled that way. It sounds like it was a local issue, not something that should have became a federal issue. Is that... Would you say that's probably right? Like, it should have just been handled by the local...
Well, it is right, but I think that anytime we take a humanitarian... Too much of a humanitarian interest in something, whether it's in our own country, whatever it is, X, Y, Z, what you're really saying is, I'm sending in the military to kill people, including children. And as a primatologist, I've even had this said to me about apes. So, you know, I tend to have this, I think we should not get involved in other countries. So there are apes in other countries who are losing their habits. It's very sad, but I don't want to send my money there. And I do not want to send American troops to protect those apes. Okay?
No, shouldn't. And that's interesting, like the wildlife, the American U.S. wildlife fish and game somehow has some sort of vested interest in wildlife species outside of the U.S. Like, how is that in their jurisdiction? That's almost like a form of colonialism, but America never wants to say that we have an empire. But that sounds...
Interesting. Yeah, it kind of is. And the Jane Goodall Foundation is behind it. So actually, we're sending money to the Jane Goodall Foundation. We're sending tax money to the Jane Goodall Foundation for her to do whatever it is she's doing there. And what if somebody attacks her? What if somebody attacks her, you know, some local African tribe? Are we now?
Yeah. Why do we use taxpayer dollars to substitute? Not that I have anything against Jane Goodall, but she has enough celebrity at this point in her life. Could she not, like, do her research through her own funding, is what I'm thinking.
She's leveraging that celebrity, and she believes that she's doing it for a good cause. And I can't look into her heart and say that she's not. So I'm trying not to, you know, I'm not trying to read into her mind But it's not going to end up, it's not going to be a good thing for anybody, including those apes, if we continue on that path.
Yeah, I understand that. But just I guess what I'm asking, just with, not that I even agree with what she's doing, but should U.S. taxpayer dollars should even be paying for that? I guess what I'm saying is, if she's doing what she wants to do, not that I agree with what she's doing, shouldn't she pay for that herself? Like, why do we need to subsidize these projects overseas? I guess that's what I'm saying. Or even locally, too. You know, the more I've learned about it, like, they always tell us that we need to meddle with this species and that species. And then it turns out later on, like, the amount of money that they waste in trying to decide what species of plant should survive over another is ridiculous. Like, when they decided... Yeah, like, I think I told you this story, that there's this beautiful, fragrant plant. It's called Spanish broom. It's similar to Scotch broom. It looks like a yucca plant. It has these fragrant yellow flowers. One of my favorite memories, like, just when you would drive down the mountain, was you could smell this in the springtime. But they decided in 2011 that it was a noxious plant, that it was a weed. So they contracted this group to spray all these plants. Like, it was hundreds of thousands of dollars. And they came back eventually, so I don't understand, like, why were taxpayer dollars spent trying to eradicate a plant that they determined, oh, it wasn't here before the Spanish arrived. So they wanted to try and take our ecosystem back to a time prior to European arrival. and they were spending taxpayer dollars on this idea. It just was,
it's pretty silly, because if you go far enough back, you know, the Americas were connected to Europe and Asia.
So. I know, that's funny. And then if you go back just a little bit farther in time, like Leif Erikson, some say that he actually went as far as the Great Lakes, and they've done DNA research to find that, like, Icelandic DNA can be found in some of the tribes in the Great Lakes region from the time with some of Leif Erikson's followers, like people that came with him. And
well, some of the Cherokee may be Phoenician, you know, you really don't know.
Yeah, that's what they say too, like the Phoenicians came to America. I've heard of that. I actually would believe that they could have, because they were such great seafarers, and they're was this one Phoenician researcher. I guess his last name was Hanna, because I was looking at that Hanna page where they were talking, and he said, I researched the Phoenicians. He was from Lebanon, which you would probably find fascinating. He said that he believed they came to the Americas, and he was doing some sort of dissertation on it. I'd have to go back to that page and find that, but
yeah, I thought that was kind of interesting. I'm very interested in that.
Yeah, I'll have to find it again. It was just this discussion about everybody that had the last name Hanna. So anyway, yeah, just why do we spend taxpayer dollars on these things that really have no reason? And ecology changes over time. So anyway.
Yeah, it's even something, you know, you may have seen that I've been following those monarch caterpillars on the milkweed lately.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, they're pretty.
Yeah, they're pretty. And I like monarchs and I like milkweed. But right now, for some reason, there's a government push to push those particular butterflies, those particular plants, and the monarch isn't even a pollinator.
Hmm.
So
why are they pushing a plant, insect that's not a pollinator? Is there a reason? Do they want to eradicate like a certain species of plant?
No, there are people who have been studying the monarch butterfly. It has a very interesting migration. It mm-hmm. comes all the way from Mexico to the United States to Canada, and then it goes back again and overwinters in Mexico.
That's what they say, but you know what I found out? Our monarch butterflies never leave this area. Some of them do go to Mexico, but we actually have some, they just stay here in Southern California. Just like some of our Canadian geese are really lazy little children, and they found out that people will feed them at the different ponds, so they just don't migrate back up to Canada. They just stay down here.
Yeah, and there are definitely monarch butterflies in Mexico who never leave Mexico. Why should they leave? It's perfectly nice there.
Yeah. So, you can't really, it's interesting, but why are they introducing more when there's already, just to study their migration path?
I mean, it is a very interesting path to study. I'm sure, I'm not against the research. I'm just mm-hmm. saying that when the government gets involved in it and tries to get people to plant more milkweed, and sometimes they actually seed milkweed around the highways, but then they don't wait. They don't wait for the flowers to bloom, and then they mow them back down, because that's the government for you, you know?
Yeah, like you can't just let natural vegetation. I like natural vegetation, what some people consider like wild or weeds. It looks really pretty. So,
yeah,
it's the same thing as with that Spanish broom. They thought it was a weed, but it was beautiful and it was fragrant. And so they sprayed all these pesticides to eradicate it, and it lasted about a year and a half. And it's starting to come back already. So what are they going to keep doing that every year? I haven't looked to see if they're going to keep doing that, but what a waste of time that was, and money, and just that plant was never a problem. It's just somebody had this idea that because it wasn't here before the Spanish arrived, that they had to eradicate and somehow encourage, like, native plants that haven't been as dominant in our ecosystem, in the chaparral ecosystem, since before the 1700s. You know, environments evolve. They don't stay, they're not static.
Absolutely.
But anyway, so what else were you gonna share about this whole tariff or taxation or just government intervention? Was there any other topic to share about that article that you wrote?
Well, I wanted to also say that while I am a libertarian, I don't find that it's necessary to support the Libertarian Party all the time or any particular party. I think the party systems are designed to create loyalty to things that are not the ideas themselves.
Yeah, of course. Well, just like I was saying earlier, you know, when it's a Republican president, like a lot of Democrats used to like to protest war, but then when it's a Democratic president, it becomes a humanitarian mission, and they're like, oh no, it's not bad anymore. You know, like it changes, like people, their party loyalty is just tied to the leader. It's not like a consistent idea, but I think the party system is just, it's not something that I'm invested in anymore. I would rather vote for somebody who has good ideas. So there is somebody with good ideas locally, right, that you were talking about that is running for office?
Well, yeah, and it's actually not even the ideas. It's sometimes there's a local office. You're not about to overturn the government. You're not about to have a revolution.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to stay within the forms of government that we currently have.
Yeah.
And when you have to decide on the person that you're going to vote for, it's not necessarily what they believe. It's not necessarily what their ideas are. It's just that they're a good person and they're honest and you can trust them.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I decided. You know, I decided I was going to vote for Rick Dixon, who is a Democrat. And I don't agree with him on, you know, high politics or, you know, he likes FDR. I don't like FDR. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But he's running for county commissioner. He's running for presiding county commissioner. We have a county that is in trouble because there has been too much corruption. And I believe that this is an honest man. And so I'm going to support him without any regard to any kind of ideology beyond with, you know, saying, let's not steal from the public. Let's not make things any worse than they already are. And sometimes that's all you can do.
Well, and the thing about FDR, like I used to admire him, but my thinking about that has actually evolved because I mean, I had always heard like the Great Depression would have ended much sooner if we had not had the New Deal. But I was always told, oh no, FDR did great things for the country. But that is actually true that it prolonged the Great Depression. Many of his policies did. So it's not that I don't respect him anymore. It's just like my thinking about that has evolved. So I don't hold him as dear as I once did. Like, and I think it's just because I read so many left-leaning things praising him, but then there would be other people that would say, well, you know, if we didn't have like these, it was basically some of the New Deal was unconstitutional, so
it was totally unconstitutional and putting people in camps, you know, concentration camps because they were from Japanese ancestry was totally wrong, and taking people's gold and stealing it from them is wrong. But you know, when somebody's running for county commissioner, I don't think that's what he's gonna do. I don't think he's gonna take our gold. You know, he's pro-gun, he's pro-family, he has adopted he has an adopted daughter that he loves very much. She adopted her from China. So I don't think he has any of these problems that FDR has.
Trying to say is even if somebody is pro FDR, sometimes their thinking might evolve about change on that? Like, if you talk about, you know what I'm saying? Like, you discuss issues, they might have a change of mind in the future. Just a thought, you know?
Right. But I don't even have to talk to him about that because I trust the person. I don't have to worry about what he believes. It's just like I don't have to belong to his church. He's going to, you know, do the right thing.
True. No, it doesn't even matter what people believe if you trust them. If you think he's a good candidate, it sounds like there was a lot of corruption recently. So those people definitely weren't trustworthy. Sorry to hear about that.
Yeah, you know, there's a lot going on. I can't talk about it right now.
I definitely would not. It doesn't sound like something that's... But it sounds like this new person running is a good candidate, and you know them, and you trust them, so hopefully they win that office. So I think there's been some local talk like that with, not to get into it, with a politician here. I don't know as much about it because, honestly, I don't follow the local politics that much. I've followed our state and national a little bit more. But there's two groups. They would send out, like, these horrible smear political junk mail things against each other. And I would have to research it more. But one side was saying this guy did this as a district attorney. And the other side would say, no, he's great. And it sounds, I'm not saying it's exactly like what's happening there, but it sounds like similar.
No,
there's something about a mistress. I don't know, like a mistress and a trip and taxpayer dollars. I really don't know if that's.
No, it's not even like that. It's
that. Okay.
People are not hearing each other, at least not yet.
Yeah.
I went to that political gathering. Nobody was smeared. Nobody talked about, you know.
Oh, good.
Very low key. We kind of all know what's going on because this is a very small county.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Well, that's okay.
It's kind of different, and I think this is how politics is really supposed to go, is that you know the people who are going to represent you.
Mm-hmm.
The problem with national politics right now is it's so big that you don't really know any of those people, and then it gets blown it completely out of proportion.
Yeah. Well, that's good that you can support this person because he's somebody you know, and it sounds like it's a low-key local issue. So, good.
Yeah, there is ongoing investigation about what's happening in our county. It's not low key in that sense. It's actually dramatic, but I don't really want to talk about it until
not talk about that. Yeah, I understand. But just, I guess all I'll say is this person sounds like a good candidate then.
Yeah, I think so. I think he's a person I trust. And I think maybe, you know, if we had this on the national level where we knew what kind of person that is, we would get a lot less ideological and we'd be a lot more into just, okay, I trust you to represent me in this matter.
I kind of get that feeling from, like, the libertarians, though, and even, like, the Green Party, even though I don't agree with them, everything, I think some of them went kind of wacky. I feel like even with some of these third parties, even if they are running for a national office, I get more of that feeling that you actually get to know them because they don't get the coverage that some savvy politician with many backers and Hollywood celebrities backing him gets. So they're going to be more authentic. They'll go and speak to any group. Like, I've noticed that, like, with Gary Johnson, like, he wasn't above, like, going to speak to anyone. Like, even if you didn't love him, I think you could admire him for, like, stopping to talk to, like, any group of people. And I guess I heard that about Nicholas Wildstar, too, when he didn't make it into the top two. But he was willing to have dinner with, like, anybody who wanted to talk to him and find out what he was about. It seemed like they would take the time to actually do a little bit of grassroots campaigning and get to know people, even though they were running for a national office. I got that feeling that they were more candid about what they stood for, as opposed to, you don't really know what the National Democratic leader stands for or the Republican, because they're just a professional politician. So that's why I never hated Gary Johnson for his gaffe, because I felt like he was just being more of a real person and how he would be kind of, I know he wasn't all polished, but I actually admired him for that, because I felt like, well, okay, he's not a polished politician, but you can see the authentic person and what he stands for. And he spoke at some college campus one time, and it seemed like he was very articulate about what was happening in Syria, even though he forgot Aleppo. But because he didn't remember the city, in this one rapid-fire question, everybody was laughing at him, saying he doesn't even know what's going on in the world. But he actually knew more about that conflict than Hillary Clinton does. So she just went off whatever her advisor told her would be a good idea. Huma Abedin, the one that was married to Anthony Weiner, a lot of her ideas, like on what we should do foreign policy-wise, are based on that woman's research and her pet projects, is what I found out, actually.
Oh, well, that's interesting. I didn't really have as big a problem with Gary Johnson, but I had a problem with Bill Weld.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he was planted in the Libertarian Party. He was not really a libertarian, and we didn't really want him. And I wish I could go to the national convention so I could offer the bylaws change for the vice presidential nominee to be the second runner up to the presidential nominee.
That's probably a good idea. And it seemed like with Bill Weld, he did say, like, oh, Hillary Clinton would be a good person to vote for, and I'm her friend. That is an interesting comment to make when you are the Libertarian VP.
I mean, it would have been even more interesting if Donald Trump, running against Hillary, had said, I think Hillary's more qualified. You know, I mean, that would be about the equivalent, right?
Yeah, basically it would be. Although, right now they supposedly hate each other, but I don't know. Like, I guess what I'm trying to say is, at the end of the day, I don't think we're worse or better off with either one of them. I don't think either one was going to be a good or outcome, in my opinion.
Yeah, I think it's about the same. But that's not even an issue for me.
Yeah. Anyway. So was there anything else that you wanted to discuss?
No, I think I covered about everything I wanted to talk about. Do you have any issues that you wanted to
talk about? Right now, honestly, nothing specific. I am watching less of the news. I do read a little bit of the news these days, but the reason I'm not as invested right now is because it seems like the only thing you see is half the country loves Donald Trump, and then the other half of the country spends their time, like, seething with anger over everything he's doing because he's president and they want him gone. And then it seems to fester, and it's egging on this other half. And I'm kind of seeing some of this as the result in the California election. Like, people are mad that was something else I didn't really cover. I guess that John Cox person's a Republican, and some people are saying that he came in second place in the governor primary because a lot of people were mad that California was really pushing that they hated Donald Trump. So then the pro-Donald Trump supporters were stoking the fire to make him their second person. So I feel like maybe some of this hatred towards him might just result in something that they don't want. I'm hoping he's not reelected, but not so that we get a Democrat. But I think he could be reelected because there's so much hatred being thrown at him right now that his supporters are just going to support anything he does and says. So I don't really like the dichotomy that's going on in our country right now. I just find it very unhealthy. But I guess everybody else is okay with it. Like, they seem to enjoy this, like, political divide that we have in the country right now. I don't feel like we discuss anything important anymore. and everything's controversial now, or you have to be part of a movement all the time. Like, I don't, even like in Hollywood, like, why is everything political? It makes me, like, I don't detest politics, but I don't think every single issue has to be political at all times, I guess, so.
Yeah, but no, I've been seeing people on Facebook, and some of them are diagnosing why somebody is a Republican. They say, oh, all Republicans have this DNA that makes their amygdala larger.
Oh my goodness, that's ridiculous.
Right.
And it used to be that people were civil with each other, and if they didn't agree, they could debate, or they could say, oh, like I was reading on the Libertarian group, somebody was saying that they appointed someone as their second in command because they disagreed so well. Like, it didn't seem like it was always like hostility. Like now, like everybody either agrees with each other or they disagree with each other or they block someone, because basically we are supposed to be a diverse country, but it feels like we are no longer allowed to be diverse in our opinions. Like, we're either one way or the other way, and it's all feeding a fire of hatred. And I hate to say it, but, and I know I probably say this too much, but as someone who is a former Democrat, I feel like the Democrats are really promoting a really unhealthy, like, political and social environment right now in the media. And if I was somebody with a young kid, I don't think I would want them to watch a lot of TV, because it's just, all it is, any show that you turn on is something about how horrible Donald Trump is today. Like, and I... But I guess that's it. Like, everybody else is okay with it. Like, they either love Trump, a lot of people do, or they want to hate him. And I know there's people in the middle or some people who are ambivalent. But I don't think that there's anything healthy about our news cycle right now. And I think people have control of that, but they are choosing to perpetuate this just because they didn't like the result of the last election. But you have to let it go at some time. You don't get what you want every time. So anytime there's an election,
I want.
What's that?
I said, I never get what I want and I let it go.
Yeah, and you're always so sophisticated and elegant about it. And you're not like on Facebook ranting about it. And I never see libertarians or even liberty minded people, not libertarian per se, doing that. I don't see Austin Peterson doing that. I'm just really tired of it, but maybe it's me. Maybe I'm just... I thought, well, maybe I'm too sensitive, but I don't think I am. I don't think I'm that sensitive. I just think that I'm kind of burned out on it, and I don't feel like I fit in with any of these groups right now. I don't know how to classify myself. I'm not a Democrat. I'm not a Republican. But, you know, I guess I don't have to be either one.
No.
So
you don't have to be, and you know, I think maybe if we just forgot about those classifications, everything would be okay.
Yeah, I think so too. So I don't even really have anything to discuss. I just would like to maybe go online, look at a news site that it's American-based without that horrible dichotomy. I guess if you're on the other side of the coin, like if you're looking at Fox News or looking at Donald Trump stuff, you're probably just hearing praise about him all the time. But then just other things, because I used to be a Democrat. I have to keep this in mind. A lot of people I know, a lot of people in my family are still Democrats. So pretty much all I hear every day is about how the world's going to end because he's president. And when you live in California and you walk down the street like every day, the world's coming to an end because he's president. I didn't know, like, I thought we were still here.
Yeah, we're still here.
That's what I thought. I guess maybe it's a California-specific thing. I don't love him, but I don't think he's the Antichrist either. Like, I just think he's a blabbermouth, and I don't even think he's running the show, but everybody else seems to just be losing their mind over Trump on the daily, and I think it's going to result. I hate to say this, and I was hoping in 2020, like, maybe we could get a independent person or a third-party person, but I really hate to say this. I think if the Democrats keep chipping away at this block, they're going to get a lot of people voting for him, because a lot of young people actually seem to be buying into what he's saying and really liking him because of, like, this anger. It goes even farther, like, it goes to just somebody maybe posting, like, a beauty blog or something on YouTube, and then, and I'm not anti-feminist, but I'm not pro-feminist, but sometimes a woman will come along and say, oh, you're being, like, you shouldn't let men, like, subjugate you, and you should be a feminist, and then a man will come along and say, this is, like, stuff that liberals say, and, like, I feel like it's getting really ugly right now, because everything's being politicized to that point, that I hate to say it, the result that they're going to get is that he will be reelected, and if you want to keep this angry mantra going, that what you're going to get is you're going to get him as president again. So you're basically...
It does look as if he's going to be reelected.
Yeah, I kind of see that. And it seems like he's getting more supporters all the time because of, you know, if you really just believe in your political party and you think the Democrats can put somebody better up, then get over this Hillary Clinton thing. Find somebody that's better. Find someone. I don't think they're going to find that. But what do I know? Like, I guess they, but if you want to lose another election, just keep on chipping away. I don't think every comedy show needs to be about politics all the time, by the way, because it used to be you could look at a comedy show and it was about various things happening in the world. But now it seems like there's a couple of them and that's their whole theme is just Trump. I'm like, and I pointed that out to somebody. I was like, you know, all they really did was talk about Donald Trump the whole time, right? But yeah. Nobody gets it. Like, I guess I'm... But if you say this, like, you're his fan or you're his supporter. No, I'm just kind of tired of, like, Trump hate because I live in California and I don't love him. But, like, the national pastime is Trump hate, basically, right now. So if you want to reelect Donald Trump, just keep hating him because that's what you're going to get. So, but I don't think anybody will listen to me because I don't think anybody cares what I – they don't have to. I just don't think anybody –
Well, I don't know, Julia. I think one of our goals here is that people will start listening to you and to me too.
Well, I wish people would listen to us, but I just feel like, well, maybe some people do, but we'll see. But yeah, just keep on hating him because you're his best. Actually, another person that I do like that was a Republican, Steinworth, like, that is good, that has, like, a lot of good issues about pointing out how the DeVore animal shelter, like, abuses animals, and he just wants to encourage people to adopt dogs. He's not doing anything, like, he's just encouraging people to adopt dogs. That's basically all he's doing, and he's pointing out that a government-run animal shelter is very cruel. The person running against him said he was a Donald Trump supporter and had this big sign, and it was basically kind of funny. They go, well, you basically helped me win the election because he was running as a Republican, but he wasn't a Donald Trump supporter because he actually doesn't agree with him on the wall or any of that. So he basically got elected back in 2016 because there was so much hatred towards Donald Trump that they were like shining that on him. So they helped his campaign by having all that hatred. You know, it worked out for him. So that was kind of interesting. But yeah, I guess more Republicans, like, they actually ended up showing up better in some of the elections here in California because everybody was having all this hatred. I was hoping we would get, like, some of the libertarian people, but like I said, that didn't happen. So.
No, it doesn't seem to happen very much.
So I guess that was it. That was one thing that kind of just festers in my mind. And I know that I'm not too sensitive, and I know that I'm not, like, just making this up, but that's all you see on the news anymore. Like, I used to enjoy, like, discussing current events and reading the news, but it seems like a lot of people that never had an interest in it before all of a sudden had an interest in it come this last election, but not a good interest, not a diverse interest. They don't look at other issues even. They don't even research other issues in other countries. They just assume that they know what's happening there because, like, Hillary Clinton said that was the way it was, right? Because she told, and because her advisor, Huma Abedin, has actually a certain political agenda, which I read and researched, a lot of Hillary Clinton's stances were based on what Huma Abedin believes. And there was some controversies, by the way, with her and Anthony Weiner, and it's really strange, like, the whole thing, and it kind of gets into some of that investigation with Hillary because of Anthony Weiner using a computer that Huma Abedin had. Yeah, it's not, that's another issue, but there's just some things going on.
I don't really know anything about her except for that kind of controversy that involved sex and
computer. Yeah.
And all that
part I don't care about. I really don't care about. But I guess the part that was controversial was her husband's Anthony Weiner, and he used a government computer to, like, contact people. That was part of the issue, I think.
Yeah. But, I mean, do you know whether she would, whose policies in the Middle East was she pushing?
Well, the policies that she pushes in the Middle East are to have the U.S., like, go into Syria and have a no-fly zone, and, like, to support Saudi and to, like, continue to support them with, you know,
is she, aid. So are you saying that she was...
She's a stated, like, she's a nation, into nation building. Like, she pushes a nation building agenda in the Middle East based on what she thinks is best. Like, the essentially is what I'm saying. Like, she doesn't really care, like, well, she's not, I think she's of Indian descent, but she was born in Saudi, and I'm not sure if that influences her opinions a lot, but she is very, like, pro, like, having us continue to support the Saudis and, like, get involved in other countries, saying that they have poor human rights, whereas the Saudis have worse human, it's just kind of you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Her stance on human rights. That's, and also, another thing that's really interesting about her that was linked back to Hillary Clinton, like, that I found out, like, they were always saying that the whole calling Obama, like, a Muslim started with the Republicans, but they're saying it actually started with Huma Abedin. And I can't verify that, and that somehow Hillary was involved with that a little bit. And I can't say that's when
Hillary was involved. I did not know that Huma had anything to do with that.
Yeah, they said it started with her, that she was kind of the one that, like, planted that seed. Because the one thing you have to remember about the Clintons was they always have to win, and people kind of forget because, oh, Obama, like, is actually a, he's more conciliatory than some of the other Democrats, was that, you know, he held out a hand to Hillary and made her Secretary of State. But if the roles had been reversed and Hillary had won the election in 2007, she wouldn't have done that for him. So the interesting thing was she would, like, make up stories about people or plant seeds to, like, and that was part of the reason that Obama actually ended up being nominated, was because Ted Kennedy didn't like it. He thought that they played dirty because Bill Clinton said something about, oh, well, who's this person? He shouldn't be upstaging my wife. And he would have been serving drinks to us like 15 years ago. And Ted Kennedy was kind of, like, disgusted because the Clintons feel that they're entitled to everything. So a lot of these things actually did start with the Clintons. Like, from what I've heard, they kind of played dirty politically to undermine their competition. But a lot of people sweep that under the carpet. And then that's why when they said Hillary was going to be nominated in 2016, that I just wasn't okay with it. Because I remember all these times that she would play the same thing with Bernie. But when it came to it, they were saying, oh, Bernie's being, like, anti-feminist. Like, they were trying to make him out to be an anti-feminist, by the way. And it went so far as they were saying that Jill Stein was an anti-feminist, even though it was getting pretty weird. Like, she would make up all these different controversies. So I don't know. It's strange. But yeah, anyway, I'm getting off topic. But Huma Abedin, like, she does determine a lot of the foreign policy ideas that Hillary Clinton had during the campaign about kind of pro-Saudi, but anti-other countries that don't bend to what her idea of nation building is, or that she thinks aren't good nations. So I just thought that was interesting about her.
Yeah. Anyway. I'm fascinated by the stories about her that you can, I don't know anything about her, you know, besides the whole, you know, the business with Anthony Weiner.
Yeah, that thing was kind kind of weird too, because the whole thing with him, I just dismissed it at the time because somebody said, is he a distraction? Like, is he a distraction so we don't pay attention to what's going on? And then you kind of have to wonder because, the first time he did that, like, he was in office and there was a picture of the Clintons behind him. And I guess one of the snaps he sent of himself, like, not wearing a shirt, like, some woman saw a picture of Bill Clinton in the background. And they're like, oh, that's really interesting. And then when he got outed by it, the first time his wife stood by him because he was going to go to therapy and he was going to correct himself. And then he was running for governor in New York again, right? And he got caught again, like, sexting. I don't care that he does this, but it's the fact that he's using government devices to do it. Like, he would be using a government phone to call women, by the way. Like, on numerous occasions, like, the first time, and just computers, and, like, to contact people. And then the second time when he got outed, it was kind of strange because she was, like, laughing. Like, when she's like, well, he will change and he will reform. And then the third time he got caught doing the worst thing that we all know about was this, and he somehow used Huma Abedin's computer to contact women, and some of them weren't women. Some of them, it's just very disturbing. That's a different issue. But, like, she finally divorced him or left him the third time because it was going to hurt Hillary Clinton's, like, this. It's kind of interesting, like, but that's what part of the investigation of Hillary was about. It was tied to the fact that he was using a computer. So, and that's the whole thing. Like, I don't know if he's a distraction or what. Like, I just don't, or maybe it's just a lot of strange things all together
at the same time.
Yeah, it's just very strange, though. Like, how does that happen three different times? I don't know. Like, on three different occasions, the first time he's like a U.S. congressman, and then the next time he's running for governor, and then the third time, but he maintains this relationship with the Clintons because Huma Abedin's her advisor, and let's find that Huma Abedin has whatever foreign policy ideas that she wants, but it seems that, that was another element to it, was the fact that they said that the people that were in Benghazi were put in danger because of Hillary's, involvement with that. Not to get into that, but I don't know. There's just so many issues. Like, it doesn't even matter anymore, really. It's just, she's just not the better candidate. Like, Bernie Sanders was so much better, but maybe I just feel burned by them because I feel like they always, like, to me, they consider themselves a political dynasty, and it's just a variation of royalty. But here, they, you know how we're supposed to hate Russia right now and everything Russian is bad, right?
Yeah.
It's kind of silly. What's that?
I said, I don't know why we're supposed to hate Russians right now, but
cool. I don't buy into it. But the interesting thing that they always say is that because Vladimir Putin has been in power since 1997 and he trades off office with this other person, that, but then the Clintons, they kind of do the same thing because he was in office for 8 years. His wife was Secretary of State, which is the second most powerful position in the country. She wanted to be president. So I don't know how we can call them out that way when they kind of do the same things.
It's none of our business what goes on in Russia, as long as it's about Russian politics.
It really is, but I guess, like, sometimes we would get involved and we would have different groups. You know, in Iran, under the Bush administration, they spent, like, $8 million on some group that was trying to undermine, Ahmadinejad and try to, like, discredit him and create those, like, protests. So it's not that we never have any kind of say, but we're mad still because the Russians seem to have some sort of influence in our last election, but it was just ads. I don't think it's to the extent that everybody's making it out to be. Like, I don't know. I'm just going on. But anyway, I should end here because I don't want to take up too much time going down that path.
Okay. Well, it's been nice talking to you, Julia. And Hopefully, we can do this again next Friday.
Yeah, hopefully. I'm hoping so. Have a good night.
Good night.
Bye.